an honor to be introduced by Arthur Kleiman, my teacher, who I have been studying with for many, many years. And it's especially appropriate that this is about China, because once someone is your teacher in the Chinese, Korean, and Japanese culture, they are your teacher for life. So when Arthur told me that he wanted me to fly in the morning and then leave in the evening for this lecture, all I could say was, of course, what time would you like me to be there? My job tonight is to give a bit of an overview of the situation of HIV and then to focus specifically on China. China is an extremely important country in so many ways, but it's especially important for us in the HIV department. One of the things that we've been learning over the years is that we tend to underestimate the impact of HIV/AIDS consistently. The World Bank, represented here tonight by Deborah Work-Zuti, has done a really interesting study that came out in July of 2003 that suggested that contrary to prior notions, that any impact of the deaths from HIV would be somehow compensated for by a reduction in competition for resources was actually not the right model. And the model that we must think about is wiping out this particular generation of the most active people at the prime of their lives will lead to a loss in human capital that could lead itself to social collapse in a few generations. A different way of thinking about the epidemic. It's, to my mind, a much better one. It's much more anthropological and sociological. Human beings in which so much has been invested already by their parents, who have so much to invest in their children, losing their lives right at this time, is truly devastating. We haven't seen anything like this since the Black Death, and of course we know that the deaths that occurred in Europe at that time affected those societies for 100 years. Well, what are the elements of a comprehensive response? Well, everyone knows it's prevention, prevention, and more prevention. The development of a vaccine. As our Director General says again and again, there are really only two ways to truly put a stop to this epidemic, and that's to have extremely effective prevention and a vaccine. But there are also many others, and this is just a partial list. And treatment is on that list. And at the World Health Organization, we're part of the UNAIDS family. And the UNAIDS family contains many of the UN organizations and also the World Bank. And our particular responsibility within the UNAIDS family is to think about treatment. But I'm going to argue tonight that, in fact, a focus on treatment is precisely the focus that the WHO should take and can also lead to many other benefits. We talk about an AIDS treatment gap. The estimate is that around 6 million people need treatment today. Only about 400,000 received it in 2003, and this is in the developing countries. Over 90% of those people who need treatment are found in 34 countries, and this was based on data from March of 2004. And we also know that antiretroviral therapy can offer hope for the poor, decrease death rates as we've seen, and drug prices are continuing to fall. So what's 3x5? I spend a lot of my time these days correcting notions about what 3x5 is. 3x5 is simply two numbers. It's 3 million people, and it's the date of the end of 2005, December 31st, 2005, by the way, not January of 2005. I already lose enough sleep over this goal anyway. And why would we do this? Why would we do something so crazy as to adopt a goal so difficult? Well, Dr. Lee, who became Director General in July, is very familiar with difficult goals. He was the head of communicable diseases in the Western Pacific region when he was given the task of eradicating polio. And he says he'll never forget the first donors meeting he had in Beijing. He went there and he raised exactly $0. And the donors told him, forget about it, you'll never eradicate polio from the Western Pacific region. Go home, don't even try. Well, they eradicated polio from the Western Pacific region, and he was the head of communicable diseases, and the person head of the polio project was Dr. Omi, who's now the regional director. And so what Dr. Lee understood was that you don't change big bureaucracies by telling it to change, and you don't change big bureaucracies by making new rules, because before you've even published the new rule, everyone will have figured out 15 ways of getting around it. You change a bureaucracy by giving it a goal so difficult and so close that it will force itself to change. Now, I thought that was a great idea when I was sitting in his office, and now that I'm sitting at the other end of the stick, it feels incredibly burdensome, but that's the whole point. There's unprecedented global commitment these days. My own calculation is that there's about $20 billion on the table. President Bush has put about $15 billion on the table. There's another $5 billion pledged to the Global Fund. And the World Bank has $1 billion up front and the possibility of much more once we get moving. So there's a lot of money on the table. Now, if you look at that $20 billion, if I were to put on my anthropologist hat and analyze why do we have $20 billion, is it because of the possibility of accelerating prevention? And I think the answer is no. The reason we have that money is because of the possibility of treatment. There's something about disasters in treatment, the possibility of curing somebody, the possibility of saving someone from death or some terrible fate, that tends to bring money much more than other perhaps better ideas. Stopping something from happening is not nearly as appealing to funders as taking someone from the dead. And I'll show you some pictures later to tell you what I mean. We know now that AIDS treatment in resource-poor settings is feasible, effective, and affordable. But why would WHO take on HIV treatment? And in the World Health Report 2004, which will be published in just a few days, we argue that it's precisely because WHO's core work is prevention and health systems development, working with ministries of health, that we have to take on HIV treatment. There's $20 billion on the table. Most of it is there because of treatment. That's the new money for global health. We have been screaming at WHO to invest more in health, invest more in health. And finally, we've got it. But it's all in HIV. And this is analysis partly that was done by researchers here at Harvard. From 97 to 2003, there was a $1.7 billion increase in official development assistance for health, every penny for HIV. If you look to the future, 2003 onward, huge increases in assistance for health, all of it in HIV, and the spirit of it all was raised because of the possibility of treatment. So we've got to get involved. If we want to protect prevention, if we want to ensure that prevention moves forward, if we want to ensure that this money is used to actually build a health system capable of delivering chronic care, WHO has to jump in and has to jump in aggressively. The public sector, health sector, has to have a role. Now, everyone is in a hurry, and it's about time. We should be in a hurry. We're way behind in terms of rolling out treatment. We're even way behind in doing effective prevention. So we're in a great hurry, and because of that, in many places, funders have chosen to work through non-state actors. That's fine. We've got to get things moving. But the more non-state actors there are, the more the health system, the public health system, has to be fortified. That's what we're hearing again and again. The president of Zambia in a recent meeting of UNAIDS co-sponsors said, "We think this new money is great, but we're really tired of being treated as if we were a non-registered NGO." This is the president of Zambia. And that is echoed again and again and again. We must build the public health sector, even if what we're trying to do is make sure that it can support and regulate the NGOs and the private sector actors that are now becoming involved. We know that antiretroviral treatment can accelerate prevention. Voluntary counseling and testing is still the approach that we favor, but there are different variations of it that we're seeing in different countries. Malawi has adopted 4 different approaches to testing given different settings. We think that in the clinical setting, there is a chance to accelerate prevention in truly innovative ways. Physicians, nurses, and other health workers must become the agents of prevention. They must be able to do the pre-test counseling. They must be able to do the post-test counseling. We must expand those capacities. What we're being asked by ministers of health is, what do we do with a sick patient in Swaziland who comes to our clinic? Swaziland has 40% seroprevalence. If any reasonable physician would have to put HIV at the top of their differential diagnosis for a whole range of presentations, what do we tell those people? Do we tell them to wait until the VCT counselors can come in at some point during the day? Or do we try to build those skills into the health system from the beginning. We think there's very exciting possibilities for thinking about how we protect the human right not to know, while at the same time we protect the right to health, the right to treatment, the right to know one's status so one can be treated. AIDS treatment programs require lifelong contact. And at WHO, there's a raging argument among the quote-unquote health system specialists and the HIV people. And health system specialists are saying, please, no more talk about HIV. We should talk about health systems. And we're saying right back, but wait a minute. When have we ever had an opportunity, $20 billion on the table, to do something that will require following a patient for the rest of that patient's life? That means that even if you have four different funders, Mozambique, for example, the President's Initiative, the Clinton Initiative, the World Bank Initiative, and the Global Fund are all there, all four funders. We must ensure that they can go from a PEPFAR area to a Clinton area to a Global Fund area and maintain continuity of care. And instead of saying, oh God, that's so difficult, how can we ever do that? What we have to think is, there's $20 billion on the table, we've never had this opportunity before. So we're trying our best and beginning to have some success at trying to bring the best thinkers in terms of health systems, bring the best thinkers who have been working on developing chronic care systems for diabetes and hypertension into this work so that we can design something that will last and design something that will have an impact far beyond the HIV sector. What have we done along with UNAIDS? Simplified treatment guidelines. Let me just say something direct about that. These are not second-class regimens. A study in the New England Journal on the 29th of April has corroborated our claim, which was that the way to start patients in developing countries is with two nukes and a non-nuke. And this study in the New England Journal agrees that that is, in fact, the best regimen to start with. We are not talking about second-class treatment for poor people. What we're talking about is a fundamental ethical problem. If you're talking about 14 drugs, 34 regimens, CD4 counts, and viral loads, you're talking about a very small proportion of the population in developing countries that need care. What we tried to introduce is a way to start therapy while those other elements are put in place. You can start with symptoms. Get people on therapy. You're going to need a CD4 count at some point, but if you have to wait until you have CD4 capacity before you start patients, it's going to be very difficult to ensure equitable rollout. Simplified regimens are about equity. Without them, it would be incredibly difficult to talk about treatment scale-up in a way that wasn't inherently inequitable. The AIDS Medicines and Diagnostic Service, what we're hearing is, from every single country that we go to, there is some problem somewhere. Product selection, procurement, supply chain management, post-market testing, all these problems that were there anyway, that were there for vaccines, that were there for aspirin, are now there and are being exposed like never before with the problem of procuring antiretroviral medicines. It's an honor to be here with Ira Magaziner. The Clinton Foundation has done some really wonderful work in helping to clarify for all of us what the costs are and how the generic drugs can be made, and especially around how we can begin to think about using these fixed-dose combinations effectively. Country support teams. Our department and many departments in WHO are not focused on results in developing countries. Many of the departments are focused on results in developing countries. The HIV department was not. We have deployed a staff, and I saw Dan Tarantola walk into the room, and Dan, nearing retirement, took 8 weeks out of his life to go to India to help them with their plan to scale up treatment. WHO has very little money. We've not received money to support 3x5. So what we do have is talented and committed staff who have gone to countries and begun working with them. We are committed to having a presence in countries that will scratch where it itches in this difficult process. We must have uniform standards. The UNAIDS has recently introduced the concept of the three ones. Remember that concept. That's an extremely important concept. The three ones are one national AIDS authority, one action framework for HIV/AIDS, and one monitoring and evaluation system. This is going to be a huge challenge. You've got multiple funders. You've got multiple models of care. You've got multiple endpoints, multiple drug regimens. How are we going to develop that system in every single country? We have no choice. We must. We cannot afford to descend into chaos and lose this opportunity of a lifetime. Talk a little bit about the antiretroviral pre-qualification system. This is an issue that's become very controversial lately, and I just want to clear up and describe for you what it is. It's really quite a simple thing. At some point in history, all the countries of the world, including all the developed countries and all the developing countries, agreed that in cases of emergency, like the HIV emergency, the World Trade Organization and in a number of different meetings decided that for poor countries that needed antiretroviral medicines, they could import them from other developing countries that would produce them for export to those countries. This is an agreed upon process. We've all agreed on that. The problem was that those countries that could do quality assessment in a way that would have credibility throughout the world could not import those drugs, because the intellectual property laws still were intact in those countries that had the best regulatory authorities. WHO stepped in and said, there's a clear problem that WHO can possibly help with. So under the umbrella of the World Health Organization, regulatory authorities, mostly from first world countries, but also mixed with authorities from developing countries, together set up a system of guidelines that was approved by the World Health Assembly and by our executive board, in other words, by all member states of WHO, and they went ahead and started looking at some of these medicines. So in other words, for the fixed dose combinations, it was the Swiss and the Canadians, along with others from Tanzania and Thailand and some of these other countries, that looked at the quality of these drugs. What do they do? Is WHO a regulatory agency? It's not a regulatory agency, but that's the whole point. If it were a first world regulatory agency, it wouldn't be able to look at those drugs. So we came in and tried to provide the world a service in doing that. High standards, are the standards high enough? Well, the standards were agreed upon by the World Health Assembly and the Executive Board, and they're essentially standards that are about, not exactly the same, but about the same as European standards. Is it exactly to the standard of the Federal Food and Drug Administration? It's not, but no one's is. There's not a single drug regulatory authority that has the same standard as the FDA. What about the fixed-dose combinations? These fixed-dose combinations were studied. The bioavailability studies were done. They did crossover studies. In other words, a patient would get this pill that has all three medicines in one, and that patient's blood levels would be taken, and then that patient would be changed to a medicine, to three different medicines, and then the blood levels would be compared, and the blood levels were found to be fine. So these fixed dose combinations were studied in terms of the standards that were set by these mostly first world and mostly European regulatory authorities. Transparency, this is a difficult situation. This is a difficult issue. And for generic drugs, very few drug regulatory authorities provide all the information on a generic drug. There's controversy over whether these fixed dose combinations are generic or not, and this is a very, very technical, specific issue. But what I would say is that we have to find a solution for this problem, one way or another. And I'm on the phone with the parties involved almost every week to try to find a solution. It would be great if we could all agree that certain drugs, especially fixed-dose combinations, could be used. Because if you look at the logistical problems of having 14 drugs coming from five different countries versus having a single pill that could be used for 80% of the population, the amount of work that it would take the difference is really quite large. So we need to find a solution to this problem. And in this case, what I would argue is that the role of WHO in the multilateral system is really critical. Let me go on so that we give everyone else a chance to talk. When we went out to the countries, this is what we found out. There's some really intense activity out there. Many, many people are moving very, very fast And among the new players on the field, I would have to say that the people who are working in President Bush's initiative have been running the fastest from a dead start. It's been really quite amazing. The Clinton Foundation, again, I credit Ira in this way, have been able to move much more nimbly than we at WHO do, for example, and have filled a lot of holes that we would not have been able to fill. But it's chaotic, and it's going to get worse before it gets better. But that's okay. I mean, in my mind, seeing no activity for so long, the chaos is reassuring in a way. We are intensively meeting to try to figure out how to coordinate. We must coordinate better. This is really a huge challenge. There's really more than enough for everyone to do. Immediate needs, there's so many of them. Financing, a lot of money has been pledged and not moved. We've got to get that money moving. Technical assistance on human resources is every single country. Every single country needs help with human resources. We have to ensure that governments have the capacity to deal with new actors and demands. And we have to really think about linking treatment to prevention in a way that will be scalable. The scale-up issue is something that we haven't got our heads around enough yet. Let me talk a little bit now about China. China is still a low prevalence country, and the chance is now, the necessity for acting immediately is extremely important, and they are doing it. The central government's commitment to scaling up the fight against HIV/AIDS has really been astounding in the last 2 years. When the Prime Minister visited HIV/AIDS patients at the end of last year, what we know is it had an impact throughout the region. Again, we're hearing this from our WHO representatives in other countries in the region. It had a profound impact throughout the region. So we're excited to see that kind of commitment. The provinces, though, I think have not kept up, and it's not surprising. This is true in every country. But we feel that as provinces expand political leadership, that, again, the response to HIV will mature and be much stronger. Marginalized groups, as in other countries like Russia, with intravenous drug users and commercial sex workers, we must focus on them in China. And another very encouraging thing is that there are small projects that are working extremely well. Condom use among sex workers, needle exchange, methadone programs have been tried on a small scale and seem to be very effective. But the challenges are great. 50% of the people don't know how to protect themselves against HIV/AIDS. Finally, if I can be a little bit forward and make some suggestions, China has to lead. There was a huge problem of SARS, but the public health response to SARS was really astounding to watch. The elaboration, and Dr. Shinji is very much responsible for that. The response to SARS has been really an extraordinary display of how to take a public health system and make it extremely functional in a short period of time. I think China has to become a global leader in the production of drugs, diagnostics, and other critical supplies. This is a capacity which they clearly have, and we would encourage them to look at how they may become involved in those areas. But moreover, I think that we would love to see China take on this difficult problem of building integrated chronic care systems in even the poorest regions. That's what it's going to take. And my suspicion is that it's countries like China and India who may be able to show us the way because there are relatively more resources there than in the poorest areas of Africa. The critical piece is that we have to think through this together and reflect on the lessons we're learning in a manner that can spread the innovations quickly. I think that China can demonstrate that the public health sector has a very positive role to play in a time when public health sector well, let me put it this way. No one is going to slow down so that the public health sector can catch up. And all the funders will use whatever organizations that are ready to go to try to scale up treatment. So I think China can demonstrate, though, that the public health sector can catch up, keep up, and actually lead the way. But finally, I'm very interested in learning that Vice Premier Madam Wu Yi declared the fight against HIV/AIDS a people's war. And to go from China back to the United States, I want to reflect a little bit on the notion of time and how I think we have to think about it as people who are working on HIV/AIDS. When Martin Luther King was working on civil rights in the United States, interestingly, many people who told him they were on his side wrote to him and wrote things like this: "All Christians know that the colored people will receive equal rights eventually. Eventually. But it's possible that you're in too great a religious hurry. It's taken Christianity almost 2,000 years to accomplish what it has. The teachings of Christ take time to come to earth." To which Martin Luther King responded from his jail cell in Birmingham: "Such an attitude stems from a tragic misconception of time and a strangely irrational notion that there's something in the flow of time that will inevitably cure all ills. Actually, time itself is neutral. It can be used destructively or constructively. More and more, I feel that the people of ill will have used time much more effectively than the people of goodwill. We will have to repent in the next generation, not merely for the hateful words and actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence of the good people." HIV/AIDS has been and will always be about time. What was time for this particular patient in Haiti, one of our patients in the Partners in Health clinic, in December 2002? Time didn't look very good. In a very short period of time, he was doing much better. And these are precisely the people who are most affected by HIV/AIDS, people who are in the prime of their life. What about for this child? Again, time wasn't on this child's side, but she's absolutely plump in this picture. And let's not forget the mothers. So this is really astounding. This is October 2002. I see Serena Koenig laughing. She took care of all of these patients. If we're not going to call this an HIV treatment perspective, why don't we HIV treatment program? Why don't we call it an orphan prevention program? And finally, in terms of advocacy, we've never had anything like HIV treatment that could drive the flow of moving resources from the rich world to the poor world. We've never had anything like this. This is a very short period of time. Same two people. This kind of Lazarus effect, again, is something we've never had in public health. It's better than eradication, I would argue, in terms of capturing the attention of people. We must use this power to drive a social transformation, the likes of which I've never seen before, and I feel very privileged to participate in. I'd just like to close by thanking Dr. Kleiman for inviting me, and also inviting all of you to think about time in this particular way. I wake up every morning. Now there are 79 weeks left to the end of 2005. And so my life and my everyday work is very much structured by this time. But I take great comfort in knowing that's precisely how patients suffering from HIV/AIDS feel every single day. Thank you.
Thank you very much. There will be opportunities to ask questions, of which I'm sure there are many subsequently. But let us now move on to the panel section for our program. And as Dr. Kim said, dealing with HIV/AIDS is a core part of development challenges facing the world. And as many have said, perhaps a lot of the gains in alleviating poverty around the world stand to be wiped out unless one develops effective programs. Also, as Dr. Kim sketched, this is an approach which needs all people to be involved, whether it's multilateral institutions, not-for-profit institutions, but also states themselves, and strengthening the responses of national governments and local governments throughout the world. So in that respect, we're very lucky in the next part of the panel that we can look at this question of HIV/AIDS from each of those perspectives. We'll first hear from Deborah Walk Zudi, who will talk on behalf of the strategies which are being pursued by the World Bank. And as people know, the World Bank has really shifted from seeing the question of HIV/AIDS as an exclusively health issue into now seeing it as one of the major challenges for dealing with successful development. And she is now the program director for global HIV/AIDS programs for the World Bank. Then we'll move on to Mr. Ira Magaziner, looking at this from a not-for-profit perspective. As you know, Mr. Magaziner worked very closely in the Clinton administration, where he was senior advisor to President Clinton for policy development of the White House, worked extensively on the healthcare reform ideas, and currently, for our purposes this evening, and most importantly, he's now the chair of the Clinton Foundation AIDS Initiative. And also recently, they signed a new agreement with the Ministry of Public Health. I think there were a number of people in this room who saw President Clinton speak at Tsinghua last year, where he talked about his desire to get involved with helping China in its HIV/AIDS response, and also to help it with negotiations about issues to do with getting drugs to affordable levels without violating patents, and that seems to be moving along to fruition. And then we'll turn to Dr. Shunjie, who, as Dr. Kim mentioned, has been a strong motive force in trying to galvanize a response within China and to take HIV/AIDS seriously. And I think the work of her and many other colleagues in China we've seen bearing increasing fruit over the last year, and particularly in the last 6 months, as China has begun to adopt a number of initiatives. And we'll hear from her how a particular nation state and government is trying to strengthen its response to the challenges for HIV/AIDS. So please, Deborah.
Thank you. And let me start by thanking Jim for the wonderful presentation he gave prior to my talk. And some of the things you will see, I'll be repeating, but I haven't seen Jim in the last couple of months, so we didn't even talk about this. What I'll try to do, as soon as I find out how to do this, would be to let you know what the bank has been doing, mainly in Africa and the Caribbean, and if we could see some of the lessons to be that transferred to China mainly. So I'll start very briefly with describing this epidemic, because we can't talk about interventions without being mindful of where we are. And then a little bit of the history of how the bank has been working in this field. As you know, unlike WHO, the bank is not even an agency which has been dealing with HIV. Our interlocutors in country are ministers of finance, so I'll try to describe why we got involved. We have now a track record in Africa and the Caribbean, and then I'll have a little bit of some suggestions for China, and then something to explore together. This is what HIV looks like. This graph tells you in less than 10 years, the number of people living with HIV has tripled, and there is no sign for it declining anymore. If anything, it's getting worse in some of the regions, Eastern Europe, Central Asia being one of the regions. The bank has been looking at HIV/AIDS as a development issue and also a multi-sectoral issue. Why? We used a very simple analogy. We said if HIV/AIDS reduces life expectancy, which is one of the measures of development, and if the bank is a development agency, then HIV/AIDS becomes the bank's business. You know the impacts of HIV/AIDS, and we looked at it from its multi-sectoral angle. The health sector stretched to the limit. That is one of the challenges that WHO and its partners, including the World Bank, will face in treatment now. If you look at agriculture, especially if you look at southern African countries, the drought that we have seen in Malawi and Zimbabwe has a lot to do with farmers dying from HIV/AIDS. The private sector has been affected. In education, in Zambia today, the teachers that are dying of HIV/AIDS are much more than the teachers that are being trained for Zambia. And I could go on into the different structures. So what happened within the World Bank? We tried to look at it only as a health problem. The bank we repeat ourselves many times. We say we started working on HIV AIDS in 1986. The truth of the matter was we were looking at it only as a very small health problem. It is only later on that we started looking at it as a development problem. What happened? In 1999, because Africa was the region which was hit hardest by this epidemic, we articulated a strategy. And we called it Intensifying Action Against HIV/AIDS in Africa, Responding to a Development Crisis. Why did we do this? Because the bank, it's 10,000 strong, and it's mainly staffed by economists. And the job and the work and the thinking of economists is development. We knew we wouldn't get anywhere without putting it at the center of the development agenda. With the strategy recognizes the emergency nature of HIV/AIDS as a central development issue, and also we needed to integrate it in all the sectors that the bank deals with. How did the bank used to do business before, including the country governments? First of all, there was lack of commitment. There still is, by the way, in the countries that we were focusing on. And this limited both what the bank wanted to do, and the bank itself was limited in its outlook, and what the countries wanted to do. There were insufficient resources. There wasn't a single country which had enough resources to scale up any of the programs. One thing we need to remember when we talk about prevention is prevention has never been given a chance. We need to find a single country as an example where we have done everything on prevention. We haven't. And resource was not reaching the communities. In most cases, donor agencies would channel resources to the capital cities of the recipient governments, and most of the money remains there or is committed to the communities through a bureaucratic system. There was also insufficient multisectoral implementation. After we articulated the strategy in 1999, then the bank took a step and opened a dedicated office within the Africa region of the bank. It was called the AIDS Campaign Team for Africa. The office was there, the staff was there, then we said, so what do we do now? We went to our board and said to them, give us unmarked resources only for HIV/AIDS so that we can help countries to move the HIV/AIDS agenda. Because country governments would happily come to the bank and borrow money for building roads or schools or anything else, but they were very reluctant to take out money for HIV/AIDS. So we had to create a different system. So we created the multi-country AIDS program approach. First of all, the essence of the map is to support national programs. The bank didn't go and articulate a different thing for countries. It was a program which empowered the stakeholders at all levels. We left it at a level where we only worked with the governments on a first-year plan, and the rest they could do themselves. We focused on capacity, unleashing existing capacity in many countries, and this will be Jim's headache very soon. We do have countries now who are trying to scale up treatment, but who have 4,000 to 6,000 health workers who don't have a job. So this is what the map is trying to do, to unleash existing capacity and also build capacity in the long term. We call ourselves a knowledge bank as well. So we share our experiences from different countries, and we have a mechanism where we share experiences between countries and between regions. It's a very flexible design, unlike the traditional bank projects. So what do we have now? We have $1 billion. It is on a 100% grant basis. It's not a loan. We did start out with a loan, and the bank changed its mind and said we needed to provide these resources not only to Africa, but to poor countries all over the world. We are just in the process of completing a program for Bhutan, for example, on a 100% grant basis. So what did we do? This is Africa. All the countries that you see in yellow have a MAP program, and the countries that you see in red are programs in the pipeline. At the end of our fiscal year, we would have covered countries, all countries that are eligible for grant funding within the Africa region. The white that you see in Southern Africa, these, unfortunately, are countries that, by bank standards, because of their GNP per capita is more than $1,000, are not eligible for grant funding. At the same time, the next region which is hit hardest by the epidemic was the Caribbean region. We had another multi-country program for the Caribbean. We have covered most of the Caribbean countries. Again, at the end of this fiscal year, we would have all countries that would have HIV/AIDS programs in the Caribbean. Incidentally, for the first time, the bank started funding treatment in Barbados. That was our first country where we started to fund treatment. We do fund treatment for most countries now. That doesn't mean we were only working in Africa and the Caribbean. These are countries where we have HIV/AIDS programs all over the world. So these were more or less the things that the bank was doing in the last 2 years. By the end of 2002, we realized a couple of things. One, we have, at least from the bank's point of view and from what we could do from the bank side, we have Africa and the Caribbean under control. They have resources, and our resource is not $1 billion. If you read the map, it says our commitment with the countries is a 15 to 20 year commitment until countries build sustainable capacity to fight the epidemic. The first $1 million is the which would be completed by the end of this fiscal year. We go back to our board and we will ask for another $1 million and so on. So the bank decided to open a global HIV/AIDS program, which I'm currently heading. Why did we need to establish this? Because we knew our efforts in the rest of the world was not as intense as it is in Africa and the Caribbean. The first thing we had to do was to strengthen the bank's own capacity to respond to the HIV/AIDS pandemic. And then to disseminate knowledge from the experiences in Africa and the Caribbean so that we can use it in other regions. We also participate in catalyzing resources both for the bank's activities and for HIV/AIDS programs in general. We do coordinate monitoring and evaluation for the UN system, including other partners such as the Global Fund and others. And this has a grounding on the three ones which Jim mentioned earlier. We do analytical work, and we use this analytical work mainly as for advocacy purposes. I don't know how many of you know the study which we did on South Africa last year, although we will not claim that we were the ones who have been trying to change the mindset of the government. This study, more than anything else, hit most of the people in finance and development as something which is much more than what they used to think before. We are trying to replicate the same kind of study for India, Ethiopia, Nigeria. We have a similar study for Russia, and hopefully we'll do something similar if the Chinese wish so in China. So why am I telling you all this? From this, we can see what works and what doesn't work. If countries intervene early, and if governments create an enabling environment, this I would like to stress much more, especially those people who are working with non-governmental organizations misunderstand when we say government has to step in. I don't know any country which is being run by a non-governmental organization. So unless we get the governments in place, not to do it by themselves, but to create the environment for everyone to work on HIV/AIDS, then it's a non-starter. We need donors to collaborate under a common plan. This is what Jim referred to as the three ones earlier. On the one hand, we talk about lack of capacity in these countries. On the other hand, we are the culprits who go and try to pull them in 10 different directions with 10 different indicators and reporting systems. That has to stop. And it has to be a multi-sectoral approach. I think we have 20 years of experience to show that HIV/AIDS is no longer only a health problem. What doesn't work? Well, when government backtracks on controls and controls too much. In countries where people living with HIV/AIDS are stigmatized, in countries where whoever is trying to help that country has to pass through hoops to get drugs or condoms to people, then it doesn't work. When donors compete among each other and they divide the country into different provinces, it doesn't work either. Stigma and discrimination happens to be the one thing which stands between a good program and a bad program in most of the countries we have seen. when the bank itself applies its rules mechanically, especially somebody used to say the current bank rules used to be are the ones developed for building bridges. You can't apply the same rules for fighting an epidemic. So if these things happen where the bank allowed us to break the rules and regulations in the map, that's why we could cover continents now, then it doesn't work. Are there any lessons for China? This is a favorite slide I have, which I show many times. People have now forgotten that at one point, Botswana, with a prevalence rate of 38.8% now, had a 0.1 prevalence rate in 1986, which is the current prevalence in China. I'm not by any stretch of the imagination implying that China will become a Botswana. However, there is a lesson to be learned in acting early, and also the trend of the epidemic, which you see in Asia today, is a very similar trend that we have seen in Africa and the Caribbean. The difference was in Africa and the Caribbean, the epidemic accelerated exponentially. It is an emerging epidemic. We need to focus, at least that's what the bank is trying to do now. We are focusing on Asia because we see that there is an epidemic which is driven by specific routes of transmission, which we can deal with. In China, one thing which is standing between a good program and responding early is the low prevalence rate obscures the seriousness of the problem and also the need for early action. I think China has led the way, and I agree with Jim when he said China must lead. We have seen incredible leadership during the SARS, and all of us who have been working in this field have been saying this is the kind of response we need for HIV/AIDS. The importance of political leadership, sharing reliable information on time, and dealing with an epidemic openly, and a functioning public health care infrastructure, which most countries unfortunately cannot subscribe to. These are essential elements for fighting epidemics. There is an opportunity ahead for China. The national prevalence is still very low, so there is a window of opportunity which needs to be capitalized on. I don't think any of us a year from now or 5 years from now would want to be in a room like this and say, why didn't we act in 2004? I think that's something which we have repeated so many times, which shouldn't be repeated at all. The lessons the Chinese know more than any one of us to translate what they have done during the SARS epidemic to an HIV/AIDS one. There is also a lot of knowledge which has been accumulated over the last 20 years to see what works and what doesn't work. In our experience, approaching the HIV/AIDS epidemic from all sectors in a multi-sectoral manner would help. And what do we do? Just like any other country, the bank considers HIV/AIDS as a major priority because that's the only thing that is standing between the bank and its vision. The bank's vision is fighting poverty. At this moment in time, we cannot do that without having a handle on this epidemic. So we will be ready to come and help any country that is able and willing to say, this is an epidemic, come and help us. We have a number of programs in China, which is very telling. If you see, it says infectious and endemic disease control, health promotion, which shows you that the way we still work in China is the way we have been working in Africa and the Caribbean 10 years ago, where we were focusing on this epidemic as part of only a health problem. Last 2 weeks ago, the 186 countries met in Washington. This was the annual spring meeting of the bank and the IMF. Adjacent to that meeting, we had a meeting, what we called a harmonization meeting, for all the major donors. And they agreed to adopt the 3-1 strategy, which is, as Jim alluded to agree to work under one national action plan and one coordinating body, the national authority, and also a monitoring and evaluation system. hopefully what I have tried to show is what the bank is trying to do to fight this epidemic with everyone. But the call and the action is at the country level. It is the countries themselves that have to see this epidemic as an eventual threat and call whoever is trying to help. As for the bank, we stand by any of the countries who consider this as an emergency, and we have broken our rules and regulations, and we are ready to do that to fight this epidemic in Asia as well. Thank you.
I think I'll talk from here if that's okay. In early 2002, President Clinton was trying to decide how to focus the foundation that he had set up from a policy point of view. And he wanted to focus on issues that would contribute to the Millennium Poverty Reduction Goals, the goals that had been set to try to halve world poverty by 2015. And he asked me to try to determine what he should focus on. And we went to see a number of leaders in Africa and Asia that we had worked with when we had been in the White House, ready to talk about education, healthcare, economic development, a variety of issues. And most of them that we met said to us, we really need the help on AIDS. If we don't deal with the AIDS crisis that we're facing, it's going to sabotage everything else we're trying to do, and we won't be able to be successful in any of our development goals. And we were a bit surprised because we said, well, aren't there a lot of organizations already working on AIDS? And they said, yes, but nobody's really focused on care and treatment. There's a lot of money for education, prevention, and so on, but not for care and treatment. And we can't simply let 40 million, going on 100 million people, get sick and die over the next 5 or 10 years in our countries. When you have 5, 10, 20% of your young adults infected, 30% in some countries, essentially if they gradually get sick and die, it creates a situation where more teachers are dying every year than you can train. 60-70% of the people in your health system are basically infected, and it chokes the healthcare system. And it's a situation that makes it impossible to accomplish any of the rest of your goals. So based upon those discussions at the Barcelona AIDS conference that July, we announced that we were going to focus our efforts on AIDS care and treatment, and trying to scale up care and treatment. Jim showed some numbers that are a bit generous to the world community about how far we've progressed on this, showing that 400,000 people in the developing world are on treatment out of 6 million that need it today. In fact, if you take 130,000 in Brazil and another 120,000 elsewhere in Latin America out of that number, what you'll find is that less than 100,000 people out of close to 6 million are in treatment in Africa and the rest of Asia. That is the crisis we were trying to deal with. Now, what we have done, we went to talk to a number of the prime ministers in developed countries that we had worked with also and said, how come you're not focused more on AIDS treatment? And there were two reasons given. One was that the price of drugs, the price of tests was too high, and that therefore it was just unaffordable to do effective treatment in the developing world. And secondly, that the health infrastructures in these countries were not sufficient to do good quality AIDS treatment, and if you didn't do AIDS treatment properly, that you would only help the disease develop resistance to drugs and make it worse. And therefore, treatment was not viewed as something that was viable. So what we decided to do was to move into about 10 or 15 countries and try to partner with the governments in those countries to scale up treatment and to help build the health infrastructure and demonstrate that AIDS treatment could be done. And then secondly, to try to do something on the front of reducing drug and testing costs, because as we looked at the situation with drugs and tests, we felt that the actual cost of producing these was far lower than the prices would indicate, and therefore we thought there was room to reduce the prices. Just to highlight what we've done over these past 20 months, we concluded an agreement with five pharmaceutical companies that make ARV drugs that use the WHO pre-qualification process, which we believe is a good process. As a result of that, we were able to bring prices down to less than $140 per person per year. When we first were looking at this issue, it was up over $1,200 per person per year. And we expect to be able to bring prices down even further over time. We've done this through a variety of means, but basically the companies are not doing this as a charitable endeavor. Rather, the market for developing country ARVs was very fragmented, very small volume, because mainly it was pilot projects or small volume orders of 50 people here, 200 people there. And therefore, the companies producing the drugs were not able to get scale production and do it in a predictable way that would allow them to be efficient. Because we were working in a variety of countries where we knew we could generate demand over the next 5 years, we essentially made an agreement where we would scale up demand and give them predictable large volume multi-year orders. And then we sent in some of our experts to work with their experts, engineers, on how we would scale up the factories, how they would make investments for more efficient production. And basically what it amounts to is that the companies will make enough money to cover their depreciation, cover their cost of capital, and make a little bit of money. And they'll trade what is now a low-volume, high-profit business for a high-volume, low-profit business. But it'll be sustainable, and they'll be adding capacity. Then we made an agreement also with the companies that make CD4 tests and viral load tests, which are the two major tests that are necessary for AIDS treatment. In that case, it's the R&D companies that made the agreements with us, not generic companies. And CD4 tests, which typically have cost anywhere from about $30 up to $100, depending upon the country, per test, we're now going to be in the range of about $2 to $3 a test on CD4 tests. And then on viral load tests, which were costing anywhere from $60 up to $200 per test, we're going to be in the range of about $12 to $17 per test. So we've been able now to reduce the costs. So in South Africa, for example, one of the countries we were working in, initially they were estimating about $1,200 per patient per year just for drugs and tests. Then looking at 800, we're going to be able to get that down now to about $200 per person per year. The other thing we did is we started working in four countries in Africa, Tanzania, Mozambique, Rwanda, and South Africa, which together have about 30% of all the AIDS cases in Africa. And then we've worked in the Caribbean, which, as Deborah Work mentioned, is the second highest prevalence area. And we're working in countries there that have over 95% of all the AIDS cases in the Caribbean. We partner with the governments because I agree with Jim and Deborah Work that basically governments and mainstream health systems have to be who you partner with to really scale up treatment effectively. We helped develop national care and treatment plans, which have now been adopted in all the countries we're working as the national plan to go forward. And as Jim mentioned earlier, for example, in Mozambique now, where the World Bank was active, the Global Fund was active, and a number of European donors were active, we've now pulled everybody together in support of this national care and treatment plan officially adopted by the government. And I met with Ambassador Tobias, who's running the U.S. government program, the PEPFAR program, a couple of weeks ago, and he has indicated, and we hope they will follow through, that the PEPFAR initiative will also support the national care and treatment plan in Mozambique and Tanzania and Rwanda, where we overlap, and in South Africa, so that there will, in effect, be one plan that's being carried through with everybody's support, and it's the plan adopted by the cabinet in those countries. We're now in the process of working on implementation in those plans. The Clinton Foundation is providing technical support. In some cases, we've also helped raise money. We view the Global Fund and the World Bank as the major funder partners. But we've also managed to raise some money from the Canadian government, the Irish government, Swedish, Norwegian, French, other governments that goes as direct bilateral aid from those governments to the developing country governments in support of these care and treatment programs. And then in some cases, like the Caribbean, where a country like the Bahamas is not typically eligible for grants. We've raised private money. We went to the people who run the biggest hotel chain there and had them raise money for us. In the Dominican Republic, we raised money from some wealthy Dominicans who golf on the North Coast and some baseball players and others who've done well and raised money wherever we could to try to help support the programs. Recently, we've concluded agreements with the Global Fund, World Bank, and UNICEF. to expand the benefits of the drug and testing agreements, the low prices, to countries around the world that they are funding. So it's not just going to be limited to the countries that we are working in. And as Deborah Rourke mentioned, the World Bank went out of their way to revise their normal tendering processes and other regulations to accelerate this, and did it in record time, and the Global Fund has done the same thing. And so we're moving forward in those fronts. And recently we've signed an agreement with the government of China. President Clinton and I visited China in November. We had the opportunity to meet with President Hu Jintao and former President Jiang Zemin to discuss AIDS with them. And we're very encouraged by the political will that exists in China now to address this problem. And the Clinton Foundation is now partnering with the government of China to move forward. And Dr. Shenjia and others will be our partners in China. We're hoping to provide technical assistance, financial assistance, and other assistance to their programs. Let me finish by just saying one final thing. And I must say I applaud the 3x5 initiative and Jim Kim's work in promoting that initiative in WHO, and we're very proud to be members of that initiative, partners in that initiative. Jim and Paul Farmer were among the first people I went to see when we first made the decision that we were going to get into this field, and they provided us with a lot of very valuable guidance, and I think it's very refreshing to see Jim at the WHO working on this problem. And I applaud it most of all because what it is doing is it is focusing on the one thing that matters, which is how many people are we going to get into effective treatment in the world. One of the first things I did is when I began this work, I went to visit patients in health centers, at hospitals in Rwanda, in Mozambique, and in Tanzania. And I sat down and spent a number of weeks just talking to the patients and their families. And one of the things that I remember every day is that all those people I talked to are now dead. And probably there have been three or four generations at least of other people who've occupied those same hospital beds who are also now dead because we've moved too slowly. And their families and their kids who had hopes, those hopes have been dashed. And the fact of the matter is, and again, I think Jim is being kind now that he's a diplomat at the WHO. He tends to be more diplomatic in his phraseology, but since I'm just a private sector foundation guy, I can be more honest about things than I was able to be when I was at the White House. But the fact of the matter is that, yes, there is tremendous amount of activity, tremendous amount of people running around, more meetings than I have ever seen in any group of people in Geneva and Brussels and Washington, meeting with each other and discussing and having conferences and meetings. And the net result of all that activity is pitifully few people are on treatment right now in the developing world. And there's only one measurement that's going to count, and that is how many people are we going to get on effective treatment in the next year, the next 2 years, the next 3 years. And that's why I think the WHO initiative is a very good one, because it's focusing us on that output. And that is the only output that counts. Money in doesn't count. Yes, we need the money. Number of organizations, number of meetings, all of that is important, but that's not ultimately what the measure here is. The measure is how many people are in effective treatment, and right now the world is failing. And I can tell you that from our point of view, this is a fundamental moral issue. If we, as our generation, allow 100 people to die, 100 million people to die, and tens of millions of orphans to be created over the next 10 years, when in fact those people could be treated and be living close to normal lives. That is a moral failure on a cataclysmic scale, and one that our generation would never be able to defend to future historians. It is also an issue that speaks to every other development goal we have, and I think the World Bank has and Deborah Work have done very good service to the world in pointing this out. We are just joking to ourselves if we talk about the Millennium Goals and having world poverty if we don't deal with the AIDS issue, because it will essentially undermine that goal and prevent that goal from ever being even close to achieved. And even on national security grounds, I can tell you that if you have tens of millions of orphans with no source of support, no parents, and so on, AIDS orphans. They're going to be fodder for every rebel group that comes along, every dictator that comes along, every terrorist group that comes along with money to support them. So this is a crisis we have to confront from a moral point of view. It's a crisis we have to confront from an economic development point of view and, frankly, an international security point of view. And we can't just say we're going to focus on prevention and education. We can't let all these people get sick and die. It will choke the developing countries in this world. So that is why we're doing this, and hopefully all this flurry of activity that's going on will translate into real results over the next couple of years.
Respected Chairman and the distinguished representatives, ladies and gentlemen, I must say sorry about after above excellent speeches. Now you were suffering from my poor English, so I think I'd better invite my colleague to use the PowerPoint to show my presentation, and I'm reading in English. It's more convenient for you and me. I try my best to read it clearly. First, let me, on behalf of China CDC, to express the warmest thanks for invitation to speak here. It is a pleasure for me to come to the beautiful city of Boston and the famous School of Harvard. I really value this opportunity to share the experience and the information with all of you. Now I'd like to give a brief introduction to the AIDS-HIV epidemic and the response in China. Since 1985, the HIV-AIDS epidemic in China has been increasing. By the end of December 2003, cumulative reported HIV infections were 62,159. AIDS cases were 8,742. AIDS deaths were 2,359. The China CDC and the WHO estimated that there were 840,000 people living with HIV AIDS in China, among which 80,000 had AIDS. Every province in China has been affected by HIV AIDS. Yunnan province in south and Henan province in central China are the most affected. The majority of the people living with HIV AIDS are young and live in rural area. The two largest group of HIV infections are in injecting drug users and former plasma donors. Infections among females are increasing. HIV is spread from high-risk group to the general population through sexual transmission. And there has been a significant increase in reported AIDS deaths in the past few years. The Chinese government at different levels has attached great importance and made strong commitment to the control of HIV AIDS. President Hu Jintao and the Premier Wen Jiabao made strong demands on all levels of government to make HIV-AIDS control a priority. Central government commitment has quickly translated into the new policies in the September of 2003. Executive Vice Minister of Health Gao Qiang announced China's five commitments to HIV-AIDS. He stated that China will strengthen government efforts improved the laws and the regulations and intensified the intervention on risky behaviors. China will protect the rights of HIV/AIDS patients, oppose discrimination, and will be more effective in international cooperation. The most significant commitment announced by Gaoqiang is the commitment to provide free ARV drugs to all rural HIV/AIDS patients as well as the urban patients who are in financial difficulty. In December 1st, 2003, Prime Wen Jiabao and Vice Prime Wu Yi went to Beijing Ditan Hospital to meet AIDS patients, doctors and nurses. From December 18th to 20th, Vice Prime Wu Yi went to Henan Province to visit AIDS patients and their families as well as village doctors. At the same time, Prime Wen Jiabao announced the fall freeze and the care policy. This policy ensures free ARV drugs for AIDS patients. Beyond this, it also ensures free VCT services, free prevention of mother-to-child transmission services, free education for AIDS orphans, and care to AIDS patients. These new policies will intensify the overall guiding strategic plans and the implementation of AIDS-HIV control program in China. There are three important documents issued by State Council: China's medium and long-term plan for control and prevention of HIV/AIDS issued in 1998, China's five-year action plan issued in 2001, and recently announced the State Council's call for strengthening HIV/AIDS control program. In this call, there are seven requirements. These include strengthening government leadership and clarifying responsibilities, emphasize prevention as the top priority, implement health education and intervention focusing on youth, mobile populations, rural residents and other high-risk groups, improve the surveillance and standardize the case reporting system. Furthermore, the State Council call requires the implementation of the policy of social relief, an increase in the dedication of funds for HIV/AIDS programs, and improvement of treatment and care services for the patient with HIV/AIDS. And the last requirement is to facilitate international cooperation and enhance the capacity to respond to the epidemic. This includes the full involvement of people living with HIV/AIDS, NGOs, civil society, and the private sectors. In order to lead the charge for these important new policies, the State Council AIDS Committee was established based on the former State Council Coordinating Committee. The committee is chaired by Vice Prime Wu Yi. The committee's membership includes 23 vice ministers from relevant ministries and organizations, the seven provincial governors. The committee office is located in the Ministry of Health. The director is Vice Minister of Health, and the deputy directors are from the Disease Control Department of Ministry of Health and the China CDC. On April 6th and April 7th, 2004, the State Council held the National AIDS Conference. Vice Prime Wu Yi gave strong guiding statements at the opening of the conference. Attending were vice governors from all 31 provinces, the ministers of all relevant ministries, and the directors of every provincial health, finance, public security, and social welfare bureau. After this meeting, relevant ministries published new regulations on ARV treatment, VCT, health education, etc. This regulation specified the responsibilities of the relevant sectors for implementation, management, technical supervision, and monitoring and evaluation. The Minister of Health and the Minister of Finance jointly developed the regulation of free VCT for HIV/AIDS and the regulation for free ARV drugs and common OI medicine at no or reduced charge. Clarify budgetary responsibilities of the central and the local governments. This new policy and the regulations will immediately be carried out in the China care area. There are in total 127 counties in 28 provinces covered by this project. Specific financial support from the central government was given to Zhumadian Prefecture, Henan, and Dehong Prefecture, Yunnan. Specific funds were also provided across another 15 provinces and China care counties. Strong leadership, new policies and regulations provide us with a lot of hope to reach our goals of HIV/AIDS control, but we realize that there are many challenges we face. In terms of education, HIV/AIDS awareness is lower. The stigma is a serious barrier for prevention and treatment program. To reach the WHO 3x5 target, even though we have an active VCT strategy to identify more HIV positives and AIDS cases, we still have a large bridge to gap. Among the estimated 840,000 HIV infected, only about 60,000 have been identified. Thus, 93% of infected individuals remain unidentified. Among the 80,000 estimated AIDS cases, only 7,000 has been started on ARV treatment. In treatment, there are issues with adherence, drug resistance, and effective ARV treatment strategy for high-risk groups such as drug users and sex workers. In intervention, there are successful pilot projects, some of which are done in collaboration with World Bank project mentioned before, WHO project and other international organizations project. But the challenge now is to scale them up to prevent further transmission. With all these challenges, there is great need for international cooperation. We need assistance in the development of strategic and technical guidelines to make policy into effective action. We need extensive training program for public health managers and medical doctor workers. We also need scientific monitoring and evaluation to ensure our program is cost-effective and moving in the right direction. In summary, we want to thank all of you for supporting us in our efforts to control HIV/AIDS in China. I hope that through this meeting we can receive many of your valuable recommendations and support. We must believe that we can stop this disease together. Thank you.
Let me thank the panelists, and we have microphones in both the aisles if people have questions they'd like to raise. Please let us know who you are and also who you'd like specifically to address your question to. Yes, please.
Thanks. Thanks to all the panelists, but a question for Dr. Kim with some apology for putting you on the spot. But it's my impression that many developing countries feel reluctant to either import WHO pre-qualified ARVs or proceed with domestic production because of fear of economic retaliation from the United States. So, for example, in Vietnam, where I work, they're aspiring to join the WTO, and they understand economic retaliation from the United States very well. The United States has also failed to give particularly generously to the Global Fund and instead developed PEPFAR, and now, if I understand correctly, and correct me if I'm wrong, is kind of insisting on using R&D brand name drugs for PEPFAR, and also refuses to state clearly that developing countries can proceed with importing WHO pre-qualified ARVs or proceed with domestic production for a public health crisis. So the question then is, should the WHO respond or challenge what could be considered moral outrages, I think, what role would the WHO or UN have in dealing with powerful countries?
You're my friend. I can't believe you asked me that question.
Magaziner if you like.
What I can say is, as an American, I absolutely will state that I will not retaliate against any country. And that's about as much as I can tell you. What should the WHO do? Well, the WHO, what it is doing is understanding that it has to work closely with all funders and all players at the same time. It has to continue to work on its pre-qualification system to make it, to make sure that it's doing what it's supposed to be doing it under the guidance of member states, and continues to defend it and give information about what it is. At that point, then, for us to make comments on how particular member states use their funds is inappropriate as a WHO person. But what we can do is be very clear on the technical issues and continue to state that, look, these are European regulators that are looking at these drugs, and we're using processes that were approved by all member states of WHO. I don't know what more we can do, but I think that's, a question that Ira might take on.
Well, let me just say two things quickly. One is that the World Health Organization, the World Bank, UNICEF, the Global Fund, the Clinton Foundation, the governments of Canada, the UK, France, Sweden, Norway, and I can go through a list of 20 others who make up all the major donors, are all supporting the WHO pre-qualification process, and are all supporting the use of generic drugs that are pre-qualified under WHO. I think the questions raised by the U.S. government are legitimate questions to be raised, but I think everybody else has, in thinking about those questions, said, in light of the global health emergency, we're going to move in this direction until or unless there's data that says otherwise. I think I would more say, I understand what Jim is saying is, a member government can choose to spend its money as it wishes. So if I speak as a U.S. taxpayer, let me say that I think it's probably not the most efficient use of our funds to be insisting on spending more money on the same drugs. One thing that I was heartened by in my discussions with Ambassador Tobias was that he was saying that if a government wishes to use the generic drugs, for example, the governments we're working in Tanzania and Rwanda and so on, what we're talking about doing at least is if the U.S. government money cannot go towards generic drugs, then what we would try to do is use the U.S. government money for things like training and the laboratories and other things, and then we can use our Canadian money or our Norwegian money or whatever to buy the drugs. And that's fine, because all those other things are very important to have done as well. So my hope is that this will work itself out in a reasonable way, and that it will not result in the kind of pressure you're talking about. But we'll have to see.
Yes, please.
My name is Katie Moran, and I'm executive director of a small nonprofit called the Healing Forest Conservancy. I work with traditional healers in the developing world. My question is for Dr. Kim, but I'd like the response of the other panelists too, and with specifically what their organizations are doing to employ the skills of traditional healers in helping as far as training for technical training, really, for dealing with this epidemic in the developing world. And I see it now as an underutilized resource, and I wonder if I'm right, and if any of you have any information on programs utilizing the skills of traditional healers.
I'm an anthropologist, so I'm very familiar with traditional healers. One interesting thing is I can't recall ever having met a traditional healer who didn't tell me that they could cure AIDS. They generally tend to do that. On the other hand,
with the plant medicine, I'm
yes,
sure.
Yes, right, or something. Or that they've got an idea that could really be useful. I'm clear. I think that there's a lot of activity going on. I think in China there's an active program. Trying to put both hats on, my medical hat and my anthropologist hat at the same time. I just don't think we have enough data that suggests that, for example, medicinal plants or others are effective in HIV therapy in the same way that antiretrovirals are. I think the minute that we get that kind of evidence, WHO will be happy to endorse it. We do have a whole section on traditional medicines at WHO. We have a group that's working on them. And I think what I would say is we have to be very creative. I mean, there's no question in my mind that traditional healers could have a very important role in helping the rollout of HIV treatment. Whether it's in the area of applying their own particular modality of treatment, I'm not sure. I mean, there are lots of claims that we hear about garlic and other things being, you know, critical for the treatment of HIV/AIDS. WHO cannot recommend that unless there's data, and we won't recommend it unless there's data. I think the intriguing thing, though, is working with traditional healers who understand the overall care process.
Yes, that's what I was referring to specifically.
Understand the overall care process, because what we're saying when we say HIV treatment is we're saying that we've now got to really think about the quality of the doctor-patient relationship, of the health worker, the nurse patient relationship, and provide high quality care over the life of that particular person. And I think that's a tremendous area where traditional healers could play a role. The medicinal part of it, I think we have to be a bit more careful on. That's what I would
thank you.
Say.
Yeah, I think given time, I'll move on to the next question, please.
Hi, I'm Paul Farmer from the Harvard Medical School of Partners in Health, and I'm sorry I may have missed part of this, but I have a question for Deborah Work. If we can start to provide evidence that, and the reason I'm asking this is because I think the World Bank, as Ira just said, is going to be a really key player in helping us meet goals, 3x5 goals. If we can provide evidence that good HIV care not only improves HIV prevention efforts, but also reinforces agreed upon primary health care goals, do you think it would be wise, having just heard the importance of sovereign nations doing what they want to do, could it be still a good idea to have bank-funded projects, whether they be grant projects or some other kinds of projects, have an agreed-upon set of components for an HIV program that would include integrated treatment and care? I mean, in other words, since you, unlike the Clinton Foundation unlike WHO, although the SARS experience has been instructive, the World Bank has more than just exhortatory capacity. And so you could have a huge impact by saying, in order to get funding for this, you have to have X, Y, and Z components. And I just wonder if that might not be a way to speed things up in terms of 3x5 goals.
Thank you, Paul. When we started the multi-country program, both for Africa and the Caribbean, as you know, there are many people in this room who associate the bank with structural adjustment and conditionality. That's one thing we stayed away from. The map does not have conditionality.
So we want conditionality for good now.
Yeah. What we have is an eligibility criteria. Unlike other projects, we didn't go to governments and say we have a pot of money. We said these are the eligibility criteria. Come and access these resources. So it can be done. Yeah, the short answer to your question is yes, it can be done. But the governments have their own ways of doing things. For example, currently we are having a treatment acceleration program for 3 countries in Africa with WHO. Why did we create that? Because governments were reluctant to use the MAP resources for treatment. The rationale they gave us was it's not going to be sustainable. But we said, yeah, but we will be with you and there are other players. So to demonstrate that it is sustainable and can be done, we are doing this thing on the side to show that it can be done. The answer is yes, the bank is committed, and we are ready to change whatever is necessary. As Ira said, a couple of years ago, kind of agreement we had with the Clinton program would be unheard of with the bank. That's changed now.
Dr. Jim Kim really did fly in and has to fly out, so if you'll excuse us, I'm afraid he'll have to leave us now, but then we can maybe take one last question if it's for one of the other panelists. One of the other panelists?
My question is to...
I was going to ask Jim, but that's all right.
I thought I came here first.
No. Yeah, well, Jim is, I'm afraid, has to leave. His car is leaving in about 2 minutes for the airport, but please.
My question is to Ira. I come from Kenya. I'm a student here. And the last time I knew President Clinton was a friend of Kenya. My question is, the rate of deaths in Kenya per day are almost equivalent to South Africa's. Why did you choose Tanzania to Kenya?
It's because where we were invited. I mean, I think we have to be invited by the head of the country to come in. We can't just say we're going to come to your country. So in the case of Tanzania, President Mkapa invited us to come, and so we came. We would be delighted to work in Kenya. We'd be very pleased to work there, and we know it's a very serious problem. But we need to have an interest from the government to invite us to come.
Yeah, I apologize to other people who have questions, but we really do have to finish there for this evening. So please let's thank our panelists again and Dr. Kim.